Howdy y'all, Josh at firstgenoffroad.com again, and I'm here with my brother Joe. Joe is a coffee roaster. He has a company called straightjoe.com, and he sources coffee from all over the world, and he roasts it on Texas Post Oak. So if you're into coffee, if you're in the Texas Post Oak, check him out at straightjoe.com. He'll roast coffee, he'll ship it straight to your door. I've given a link down below. Joe here just got a first gen Sequoia, and I'll let him tell you about that here in a little bit, but he wanted to put a lift on it, so here we are. My hope is that it turns out great, and I'll give a link to that in the description below too. But first, I'm going to let Joe just go ahead and tell us a little bit about the car that he got.
It's an 02. I bought it for $3,600.
Nice.
It's got just under 200,000 miles.
It looks like it's got brand new tires on it, but we're going to make those a little bit bigger here in a little bit. It looks like it's got a pretty sweet grill guard there.
Super sweet grill guard.
Yep. And let's see what else. It had its lower ball joints replaced already, is that right?
It had them replaced. It came with a bunch of the service records, and it looks like mm-hmm. they were replaced around 50-something thousand miles.
Okay.
So they're due to be replaced again.
But at least you're not having nightmares that they're going to fail. At least you know right. they've been replaced at least one time. How about timing belt? Has it had that?
That was done like 30,000 miles ago.
Oh, nice. Okay, good.
Timing belt and water pump.
Great.
Radiator at the same time.
Perfect. What else? It's the usual, eight passenger. It's got the hatch that can actually, Joe, can we demonstrate how you can open that back hatch?
So the previous owner said that the plastic handle here broke like three times, and finally he replaced it with a metal
yeah.
one, and it's been doing good ever since.
It's done fine ever since. Great.
So it's
good. Okay, great. Perfect. And I'm assuming that the window works.
Window works.
All right. Well, there
all
you go.
The power stuff works great.
Yeah, that's awesome. So, hey, well, there you go, guys. It's a first gen Sequoia with less than 200,000 miles, with a rear hatch that works and a window that rolls down, with replaced lower ball joints and a timing belt. He got it for under $4,000. That's an awesome deal. So, today we're gonna put a lift on it, and if you sit tight, I will show you guys how we do that.
Middle of the wheel to the bottom of the fender flare, and we're right at about 19 and a half inches. And in the rear, we're about 20 and a half inches there.
The rear springs are the C59-175V. We've got big beefcake rear shocks, GS59-687. It comes with stickers and bushings and washers and all the hardware you need. And we're going with a set of Freedom Off-Road Uniball upper control arms. These are brand new to the site. These are something that I've been wanting to try for a long time. I've heard nothing but good things. So we'll install those and see what we think. Everything is sold on as a kit on the website at firstgenoffroad.com. I'll put a link in the description below. All right, first step, obviously get the truck jacked up, put some jack stands in place, and get that wheel off. And then the next step is to come right here and take the sway bar link off. So this is a 14. And the next step is to take all of these brake lines out. We're gonna need to get those out of the way. There's a couple of 10 millimeters, one here and one here. And then the next step is to come down here and get this tie rod end off there. When we take the bottom bolt out of this shock, we're gonna wanna be able to turn this whole assembly and move that axle to get that bolt out, and it'll be easier to do if we have that tie rod end out. So step one here of removing that tie rod end is to take out the cotter pin. And then this is a 19 millimeter. So now we have just a tie rod end puller. You can rent this at your local auto parts store. Straight Joe actually has one, so we're just gonna use his.
So the next step is to come up and get and take the shock and spring out. So there's three bolts that hold the coilover in at the top, and those are 14 millimeters, so we'll go ahead and take those off. There's a bigger nut in the middle. Don't take that off. That's keeping the whole spring and the shock assembly together. Yeah, so we will take that off eventually, but just not right now. So here we are now at the bottom of the shock, and we can take the bottom of the shock out now. This is a 19 millimeter. So we have a wrench on one side, and we have a socket on this side. So we'll see if we can just give this a little whack and get it out. Or turn it the other way. There we go. So this is when taking off that tie rod end comes in handy. So now we've got all that out, we can just remove the whole coilover assembly there. Next step now is to take off this ball joint and upper control. And we want to go ahead and just kind of wrap this spindle up. When we take this ball joint off, this spindle's going to want to flip this way and that way, and it'll pressure on that on the axle. So we want to just keep this spindle in place so it doesn't damage it. So yeah, we'll take this cotter pin out, and I believe this is a 19 millimeter. Again, this is the best tool I've found to separate the factory or the OEM upper control arm from the ball joint. I've seen guys use like a 3-pound mallet, but I've never really had any luck with that, and this seems to do the job just fine. So we're ready to take this boot off the ball joint. So yeah, now we can just take some paper towels and wipe off this gorilla goop so we can see what we're doing. Right here, there's a snap ring, and that needs to come out. So how we'll do that, the snap ring pliers, we'll just pry it open. And as soon as we pry it open a little bit, I'll stick the screwdriver down in there and catch it. There we go, perfect. Whoops. Let's try that one more time. And we'll just kind of pry it up kind of like that. And then we can just take our screwdriver and pop it off. Man, it's so much easier with two people. And then the next step is that, I mean, here's the thing. Here's one of the most helpful tips of this whole video. Well, the easiest way to get this ball joint out is to take an angle grinder and just cut it off there. And then you can press it out and you have plenty of room to do it. So that's what we're gonna do right now. So what we found is, you know, again, this is one of the more difficult parts. We think it's best to just heat this spindle ring up with the torch. We're gonna use our ball joint press to push this out. Again, if you don't have a ball joint press, you can rent one at your local auto parts store. Straight Joe has one, so we're using his. The other thing that's helpful is that you're gonna have to put a lot of torque onto this. We're gonna reattach this outer tie rod so we can hold this whole assembly. So Straight Joe is going to tighten this down as much as he can, and we'll put a pipe on it. All right, folks, that was not without lots of prayer and petition, but it finally came out. So now our next step is to take off the upper control arm. There's a nut and a bolt. They're both 19. There's two little flaps that you need to take off. Can I get you a better picture of that? Sometimes it's hard to take these off without breaking the clips. If you break them, it's not a big deal. You can replace those clips. I'll give links to new clips in the description below. And then this bolt comes out. It takes a little work, but you should be able to get it out without breaking anything. There's a harness over here that we're gonna try and squeeze it past without messing it up. There we go. Didn't take out a harness, got the bolt out. And the upper control arm. Anyway, so we'll put this on, we'll see how it goes. The castle nut that comes off your OE ball joint won't work. It's too thick, and so, and we can't torque it down tight enough to get to where the cotter pin will work. So we use this one that I just had laying around. And as you can see, it's shorter, and we can make the cotter pin work. So this is the one that we're gonna use on our new ball joint. Here's our new Freedom Off-Road Uniball upper control arm. It is a tight squeeze. So we're gonna do our best to squeeze it in. The best way that we found to do that is we line one end up and we use our screwdrivers like a set pin. There we go. And we have a rubber mallet, so we can just kind of ping it, adjust it as needed. Yeah, we just used the screwdriver on that end and a little pry bar on that end, and we just made sure that we didn't mess up the rubber bushing, and we just kind of pried it into place, and that seems to work out okay. All right, so this is gonna be our new setup. We got rid of the factory shocks and coils up front, and so now we're switching to an Old Man EMU shock, an Old Man EMU 2887 spring. The shock comes with a spring seat, which is gonna go on kind of like that. It comes with some bushings to go on the top side and bottom side of the top plate here, right? And a new nut. And here's our factory top plate, but we can't use this bushing anymore. So how we're gonna have to set this up is kind of like this. We get rid of our factory spring insulator, and because the thing is that this insulator is too wide to fit here, right? So we can't use it. This spring is too narrow, right? So we gotta get rid of it, and we switch out to this one, and that fits in there perfectly. So now we can just take this and put it here, and now we've got our old top plate with our new insulator, and it fits our new spring just perfectly. We can install it on our shock and we're good to go. All right, so this is what we have. We have our new Old Man EMU shock with the 2887 spring. We have our new poly insulator, and we've got it all mounted up, and now it's just time to install it. rolling?
Mm-hmm. Are you rolling?
Mm-hmm. Font thumbs in the way, that is. You getting it a little bit?
Barely.
Okay, it's on. So yeah, put the cotter pin in. Our brake lines back on. All right, so now we'll put the wheel back on and we'll be good. To make sure that the driver's side rear wheel is chalked, and go ahead and get this rear end up off the ground on the passenger side and take that wheel off. We'll go ahead and start taking off the rear shock. That's a 17 millimeter bolt. All right, so what I'm gonna show you is this. This is one of the, not difficult parts, but it can be. So this is the bottom shock mount that we just took off. You follow the shock up, and the other end of it is up there. This can be a tough one. You need a close-ended ratcheting wrench to get this done. And I'd also put a little grease on the threads. And also, as you spin, this thing is gonna wanna spin too. So we're gonna try and prevent that from spinning. I'll show you how I do it. I'll put some grease up on the top of these threads here. It's not a big deal. Now, I know you guys have been working out on the weekends. And this one's gonna pay off. Yep, the whole shock is turning. So we're gonna fix that. We're gonna put a set of channel locks on these and just use a C-clamp and clamp it down. And that way, as we turn that shock, it's gonna start to, these channel locks are gonna push against the frame and it'll keep it from spinning. So, yep, as you turn, that shock turns, and the idea is that eventually it starts hitting something else. Ooh. This is where a lot of guys will get a Sawzall or something else and cut this shock off. But I've always been a little bit nervous to do it because I didn't know what else I was going to mess up. For me, it's kind of a blind cut. So if you can get it, if you can just unbolt it, I think it is better to do it that way. Definitely greasing the threads, I think, has really come in handy. All right, so then we can take our little hammer and just bang this shock out. So here's our shock. All right, so here is our old shock, our old rear shock, and then our yellow Dobinson shock is the new one. So about 4 inches longer than our factory shock. Yep. Total on the old.
About 27 and a half there.
Yep.
And then about almost 31. There you go. And the other thing that it comes with is this our bag of extra washers. I think we get extras because it just kind of depends on your application. So if you look at our factory mount, we have a washer, bushing, we have a washer, we have a spacer washer, a bushing, and then another washer, and of course a nut on top. And then here we don't have that. We're missing one. So what we want to do is take one of these, and what we're going to do is this big one, and we'll put it on kind of like that. And that fits into our little slot in the car, and then we can put this back on top with a couple like that, and in that way we can space these washers. And this will help the shock align better in the car, and also this prevents premature wearing of the bushing. So straight Joe is just gonna push on that shock and compress it all the way down and just kind of hold it that way. He's got the upper hardware off. Also, this shock comes with what looks like an extra shield on the bottom side of the shock, and our best guess is that that is just that faces the front, and it maybe acts like a little protection against any road debris or rocks or whatever. I could be wrong about that, so if anyone really knows, put it in the comments below. But we're going to mount this shock with the little armored piece facing forward. So yeah, then we just let it go and guide it up to where it needs to be on the upper shock mount. Then straight Joe can put the he can put the retaining washers and the bushings in place and use our nut and just bolt it down with our ratcheting wrench. So it turns out that our OEM was a 17 millimeter, our Dobinsons is a 19 millimeter. So we're just gonna ratchet this down until it's nice and snug. And then once it's back on its own tires again, then we'll crawl back under here and finish tightening it down. The other thing that may be helpful is as you're tightening it down, this has a tendency to spin. So it's new and we're gonna try and just hold it, but if we can't hold it, then we're gonna go back to the whole C-clamp trick that we showed you earlier. And now we have the upper mount in place, we're gonna go ahead and bolt down bottom shock mount here and just tighten that until it's snug. This is still a 17 millimeter. So now we have our shock in, and so the next step is to create as much space as we can between the axle and the frame, because we need to take the old spring out and put the new spring in.
Now that we have our shock in, we're gonna try and create as much distance between the rear axle and the frame as we can. And to do that, we're going to use this little bottlenose jack and just jack up and create some space. That way we should be able to take the old spring out and put the new spring in without too much trouble there.
Old spring, new spring, spring seat. So what's gonna happen is actually these springs are upside down. It looks kind of like this. And so now it's gonna look kind of like this, right? And let's count the turns and whatnot. Let's see. Let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 turns. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 plus turns. This is a linear spring, this is a progressive spring. So you'll see these springs, these turns will touch each other when we get it installed, and that's normal. Original spring is about 16 1/4 inches. Replacement spring is about 18 1/8. This was hard enough to get out. This will be even more difficult to get in. We're going to use our spring compressors and compress this spring until it's about the same height, so we'll have an easier time getting that spring back in again. We'll put the spring seat back and we'll try and line it up the bottom side with how it was originally.
Hold up. Who's coming? Okay.
Aha. Uh-huh.
There it is.
Okay. So now we have this spring in place. We can take the compressors off. On
on the other side, on the driver's side, we had to cut off this parking brake cable retainer. But on this side, there seems to be plenty of room, so we're just gonna go ahead and leave it.
And then we'll just take out this bottom jack. All right, so we got the spring in place, shock in place. Now this next step is to just make a little room.
Let's get a final measurement here. So it's the middle of the wheel well, or the middle of the wheel to the bottom of the fender flare. They're 23 1/4. And in the rear, we are at about 24 1/2. 4 inches.
4 inches.
That's the difference.
On the back and about almost 4 inches on the
front. Yeah, so this is gonna settle a little bit, but we're sitting at least 3 inches over stock, front and back right now.
All right, guys, here it is. It is the 3-inch lift found at firstgenoffroad.com. We actually swapped out the normal 3-inch spring for a progressive spring, and it sits a little bit taller in the back, but I think it's gonna settle just a little bit. But we got at least 3 inches in the front, a little over 3 in the rear. So we have Dobinsons in the rear. And we have the old man EMU shocks and springs in the front there. We also have Freedom Off-Road Uniball upper control arms. This whole kit is available at firstgenoffroad.com. Size tires are 285. 7516 on factory wheels. Rubs a little bit on the frame at full lock, but it clears everything else. You can see right where it's rubbing right there at full lock, but beyond that, it clears everything else just fine.
Go to straightjoe.com and get some fire roasted coffee. Go to firstgenoffroad.com and pick up the lift. Thanks for watching, guys. I'll see y'all out there.
Bye.
Yeah.